Is that you, Miss Nightingale?
Please, may I call you what the others do? The lady with the lamp?
Of course, my son. We'll have you on your feet again in a trice.
No, you won't, our lady, for I've been shot in the back.
Really? So you have.
Please, our lady, please. I know it's crazy, but just say you'll marry me. I care not for living, only to make you my wife.
I care not, for I'm married to my scalpel. And my Hippocratic oath is my only wedding vow. God has put me here to save lives, to cure these wounded boys with their ailing limbs, and to soothe their fevered brow. To give others my gift of healing, and to raise mankind from the depths of his suffering and pain in this desolate land. And if I can say... Oh, I'm sorry, but if he doesn't shut up, I can't say my lines.
What? Okay, save the red.
What the hell is the problem this time, Tamara?
They're moaning all over my best lines. How am I supposed to act with that ruckus going on?
Listen, Tamara, these guys are in pain. They have serious war wounds, big holes in crucial parts of their bodies. I moan if I go to the dentist, and that's just for a tiny filling. Some of these guys are wall-to-wall lead. Of course they should be moaning!
Is this show about moaning extras or about Florence Nightingale? Tell me, David. And when you made up your mind, I shall be in my trailer. Stefan! I need you!
Do you know who she is?
What?
You're not even worth the air she breathes.
Okay, I've had it. That's it. My ulcer is giving birth and she is the mother. Do you know how much money she's costing us? Get the network on the phone.
Tamara, don't move so fast. Your hair's deflating. I can't believe he interrupted that great moment. He's calling the network. I think he just played your last scene. Exit, no applause and kit.
Look, I have saved 28 lives since lunch. They'll never fire me.
I hope not. What's going to happen to me? Already hyperventilating.
Listen, Stefan, let me tell you something. This show is nothing without me. Absolutely nothing. They will never, I repeat, never... All right, I was wrong. It does happen. That director obviously hated women.
Oh, I'm absolutely shattered. Maureen, you're her manager. Surely you could have done something.
I should have gagged her, but I wasn't there. But don't worry, honey. We won't leave you till you're back on your feet again.
Mind boggles how they're going to be able to finish that miniseries without me.
No, we've been over this before. Our Lady of the Lantern steps on a landmine, and her ghost carries on. We just see a scalpel hovering above the battlefield, and that's you. Sadly, I am not the agent of the ghost.
Well, I think it's a disgrace. I mean, who would have heard of Florence Nightingale if it hadn't been for Tamara?
So, what is this that we're standing in?
A queue. You English invented it. Now stand in it.
Pedestrians, and I'm standing amongst them.
Weren't you Amelia Earhart?
Yes, I was.
How you flew that plane single-handed, alone over the Atlantic.
Thank you. I had help.
Emmeline Pankhurst?
Yes.
Thank you for doing so much for the women's movement.
Oh, it was nothing.
When you chained yourself to those railings and burnt your bra, while it was still on, you were such an inspiration. I went upstairs and set fire to all my smalls.
Well done. Maureen, where's the limo?
Yeah, thank you, ladies. Thank you, thank you. Tamara, may I remind you, limos are no longer part of our reality. We aren't working at the moment, but hopefully for all our sakes, we will be again soon. So at the moment, we're playing woman in street, looking for taxi.
I've been completely miscast.
Just word, you were superb. I loved you as Winnie Mandela.
Thank you. I didn't play Winnie Mandela. Did I? Thank you. Goodbye.
Why do we have to stay at her place? I would have been happy with a little suite at the Dorchester, personally.
She wanted to stay with the children. I'm not kidding.
She's a mother. Well, apart from anything else, it's a physical miracle. I have more stretch marks than she does.
She only grew one. She adopted the rest. Was I Winnie Mandela?
How many are we discussing here?
A big bunch. A gaggle.
I should play Winnie Mandela. I like it. Winnie the woman. What do you think?
But Tamara, she's black.
Do the networks know?
Yes?
And you are?
Mei Chow. I live here.
And she is?
Your daughter.
Baby! Mama's back.
This is Su Ling. She started public school and is very good at netball and volleyball. This is Kim Chin. She's specializing in domestic sciences.
Isn't that fascinating? As in dusting and hoovering? I spent a fortune on sending her to the best school in London and now she's cleaning it.
And I want to be an actress like you.
Why do I have the distinct feeling I'm watching a rehearsal for The King and I?
Oh, I can't believe you're all so grown up. Isn't it funny? They've all aged and I haven't. How old are you now, darling?
11 and a half.
11 and a half. How old does that make me?
I'll give you a clue. If you were a dog, you'd be 770 years old.
Come on, children. Mommy's got some beautiful presents for you. Mommy always got you everything you wanted, didn't she?
So now, look what Mama has for you. There's one for you. One for you. And one for you.
Well, come on, darlings. These are collector's items. They'll be worth a fortune one day.
Oh, thanks.
They were left over in the shops.
Mm. Oh, there's another one. What's your name, sweetheart?
That's the maid.
Oh, sorry. Well, what are you staring at? I've got a mountain of laundry in my suitcase and everything needs pressing.
When are you going to be on telly next? All of our friends want to know.
Well, that's what Mummy wants to talk to you about. You see, Mummy's not going to be on telly for a while. I've got to have a very serious operation.
You tell that to your friends.
Oh, I don't feel very well. I think I need a bit of water. Oh, excuse me. Where's the kitchen?
I forgot.
Hello, Mum.
Oh, my God. David! My baby. Oh. You remember how we used to sing together? Hmm? Itsy bitsy spider crawled up the water spout. Come on, you know the words.
I speak English now, Mother. I've learned it over the last decade or so.
How'd you get so tall?
Well, you know how one gene divides and then they divide again? I think it's called mitosis. Well, and then they form cells and the next thing you know, you have growth. I'm sorry. But it happens.
Let me make your sandwich for you. Where's the fridge? Oh, there it is. So, how's your father? Still waiting to be crowned the next Olivier?
Well, he's auditioning for a commercial for Chocolate Covered Nuts to play lead grey squirrel. Mm. I watched him practice. He did some brilliant nut crunching. I thought he was great.
Oh, really? Run that by me again, David, darling. How did Larry Olivier do that nut-crunching scene? Whatever did he and I have in common?
Me?
Oh, yes, darling. And you were wonderful. There. Now, Mama is back.
God damn you, children! I'll steal you alive if I trip over one more ghastly American rollerbladed skater.
My God! Look what the cat dragged in.
Ever the charmer.
That's the husband. You can watch this. I can't.
May I ask what brings you to this humble isle? Long time no here. Our American care packages have stopped being dropped. They help the needy boxes from Saks. Rumor had it you were dabbing the wounded in the Crimea, gluing limbs back on, but there's been nothing. Not even a photo of you in full pout, signed to the family, masses of kisses tomorrow.
Ian, darling, if you really wanted to know what I've been doing, it's been in most of the magazines, and since when were we pen pals? You know you're really, really happy when you see my signature on the bottom of a check.
Huh.
I've sent him enough cash to buy himself a theater, but it'd still probably fail the audition.
Oh, excuse me, I'm eaten up with jealousy when I think of the part you've given the world, that Joan of Arc she gave. Ha! And the mascara never melted, even in the flames.
Well, somebody had to make a living around here, and it certainly wasn't going to be you. He insisted upon playing Norwegian manic depressives, who speak so slowly they eventually have to kill themselves.
Oh, bravo, bravo, what lines. There speaks a woman who's played every great female in history, with dialogue scraped out of the back of Barbara Cartland's mind.
Now, listen, children, listen to this. I want you to hear this because it's very good for you to hear this, right? Do you really think that I liked being away from you all those years? Because I did not. I really missed you. While Daddy there was dressing up as a rodent, Mummy had to get up and slave away day and night, night and day, getting up at 5 o'clock in the morning, playing any part at all just to keep you and him fed. Which, judging by your bulk, Ian, dear, unless you are very, very pregnant, took 12 years of my life. So understand, Mr. Squirrel, where you can shove your nuts.
God, I love that woman. She never came in here, even when she lived here. On all these mouths to feed, I've been a slave to this stove.
Tell me, Maureen, what season is it out there? Do the buds still open and close? Ed.
Ian, if you could not put her under any pressure right now, try to hold back. She's just very delicate these days.
Delicate? Are we talking about the same person?
Listen to me, Ian. I'm telling you, don't upset her right now.
What are you talking about? She loves it. Or she used to telephone me twice a week for a dose of abuse. She'd be particularly vicious. I'd riposte with something equally repellent. I could hear her purring on the end of the line.
Oh. Oh.
If she wasn't at home, I'd leave some loathsome message on her answering machine. She wore the tapes out listening to the repeats. What's the matter with her? She got some horrendous disease.
Worse. She got fired in a very public way, and no studio will touch her. You know what happened to Nixon? Times two. Don't say anything.
I won't.
Morning.
I heard you just got fired.
Thanks, Maureen.
Well, he had to know. I mean, you're here, not there. It's suspicious.
Well, I was right. That director didn't understand me at all. He said I was being difficult. Can you imagine?
What are you talking about? You were born difficult. You came out of your mother waving a lawsuit. Don't give me all that. I know what goes on in Hollywood. The more difficult you are, the more money they throw at you. Come on, my little barracuda. What really happened?
Leave it alone, Ian.
No, no, it's all right. I just insisted on getting the things that I deserve, that's all.
Ah, I know that theory, yes. You know, she was difficult when she first started out. She even insisted on her Pekingese being flown first class to Singapore, where she was working. I had to go coach.
Oh, don't talk about Pierre. Can't bear it. She loved that Pekingese.
Oh, she might have loved that Pekingese, but it still got eaten in a wonton between the airport and the hotel. Quite right, too, little sod. And then she insisted on beauticians working on every part of her body. I don't know which part. Toes, lashes, covering up the cracks. No crevice was left unturned. You know, she cost more to maintain than a Boeing 747. So what's the real trouble? What is it, Tamara? What's so terrible that's happened? Had a cameraman beheaded for shooting a bad angle?
Let's just drop it now, shall we?
At least I had an angle. I wasn't just some blancmange spouting Shakespeare.
Oh, come on, Tamara. What happened? Complained a little too often about the costume being a little too snug.
So speaks a man who for the past 20 years has worked in nothing but tights, a turtleneck and a half-filled codpiece. I'm going now.
Had one too many birthdays.
Oh. Happy.
How is she?
She's breathing anyway. I can't hear anything besides that constant munching noise.
She's crumbling, Maureen. She's locked herself in there for a whole week and she's eating. I've never known her eat before. The delivery vans are parked around the block. She's standing at the window there flipping pizza straight into her mouth.
Why do I feel like I'm on Roseanne?
Oh, what can I do? She thought they'd call her back to L.A. by this time. They didn't. And believe me, when you die in Hollywood, they smell the corpse over here.
Don't worry now, you're just a little bit depressed. Look at yourself. Look how gorgeous you were. How thin. Look at those cheekbones. Remember them? Makeup, I can do. Archaeology, no.
Don't cover that up. Come on, baby. We're going to put you back together again if we can. Think of all you've done. If it weren't for you, people wouldn't know who's who in history.
No! No!
Come on!
Stop it. Don't you dare! Don't you dare! Spit that out. Spit that out! Thank you. Tamara, don't do it for yourself, but think of Maureen and me.
Please, Tamara. I can't just sit there watching you spread all over the table. Suck something in.
I'm too tired to suck something in. I have been working out every day for 20 years, so just let this exhausted woman enjoy her children before she croaks. All right, children, help your mother out of her coma.
I have seen our lady.
Yeah!
And she has chosen me to visit.
This is you, as Joan of Arc. Aren't you fabulous?
If you do not believe me, you can burn me alive.
We're alive! Hallelujah! Joan of Arc has come through the flames! Stefan, heat up the rollers. I just got her a spot on the Clive James show. Somebody cancel.
I won't do it.
I just want to be left alone. I don't want to act in any more awful miniseries. I just want to be remembered as a loving mother.
Please, Tamara. Please, think of me. Don't send me back to those horrid beauty saddles full of yappy old liver-spotted corpses screaming more bouffant. We're not leaving till we look like Barbara Bush.
Think of your children. You've given them everything and they want more. Oh, somebody help me. I'm stuck to this bloody table.
My God.
That's the one I remember.
Hey,
waiter.
Thank you.
Thank you.
One more.
One more, please.
One more.
Hang about, chap.
Who's the bimbo?
Oh, that's that girl. She's great. She's in, nobody.
Do you mind? Look, just stop staring, will you? I know what you're looking for. It's all hers, okay? All her own teeth, lips, nose, eyes. It's all hers, the genuine article. So you can just stop gawking.
Maureen.
What are you still staring
Maureen.
At?
She's blind.
Stupid cow.
I hope nobody puts the aerial up on that car.
Thank you.
And now, to welcome a truly inspiring woman. She started out as the only British film starlet who could wear an American bra without getting her wires crossed. But it was after she landed in America that her career really took off. In Hollywood, she plumbed new heights in one miniseries after another, as every historical female figure from Marie Antoinette to Marie of Romania, not to mention Marie Curie, in an original portrayal that placed new emphasis on the great scientist's hitherto neglected talents as a ballerina. Finally, scaling the depths of compassion as Florence Nightingale, she stepped on a landmine and her light went out. What happened? Who better to answer that burning question than Tamara Hamilton? So, Tamara, they killed you off then?
No, Clive. They didn't kill me off. I wanted to die. After all, I played everyone who was anyone. There was no one left me to play.
You thought that as you stepped on that landmine?
Yes, Clive, as I put my foot down for the last time, I thought just that.
And when you were lying there dead, what did you think?
I'm a method actress. I was dead. I didn't think.
Well, Tamara, you'll have time to think now because it's time to meet a young actress at the beginning of her career. She's starring in her first big primetime miniseries, but it won't be the last because she's cool as a button, cute as a cucumber. She gets hyped out of her head without even having to hustle. She's TV's Can't Wait Crown Princess in Waiting. She's Sharon Emanuel.
Everybody, I'm so excited. Whoops, my skirt's too short.
So, Sharon, how are you enjoying your success?
Oh, it's totally radical. I've got my own condo on the beach, and I've met Prince, or Puh. He's just a letter now, and he's my new best friend.
Any truth to the rumor that you were going out with the producer of the program at the time you landed the part?
Like, no. I mean, we slept together and everything, but you'd know about that tomorrow. No, seriously, Clive, I got the part because I'm young and natural looking, and I think that's what people want to see. I think once you're past it, you shouldn't really appear on television.
Tamara, were you very much like Sharon when you started?
I was further up the evolutionary scale, if that's what you mean, Clive.
And Sharon, would you like to end up like Tamara?
You mean tossed on a landmine? No, no, no. But my mom and my auntie always tell me how fabulous you were in your old films. I wouldn't know. I just think people should know when to quit, Clive. I mean, because what's happening is very young and fresh and very happening.
Any advice you can give to Sharon tomorrow?
Yes. I can only advise you, Sharon, to speak very fast because your career should last about the lifespan of a fruit fly.
At least it's a young fruit fly.
All right, my dear.
Let me tell you something totally radical. When you were just a tiny bit of floating fetus, I had 75 million viewers waiting for my every breath. Men left their wives in the hopes that I might let them light my cigarette. The Pope even wrote and asked if a drink would be out of the question. With one look, I could turn gay men straight and straight men gay. And to get where I am today, do you really think I had to sleep with the producer? Oh, no, my dear. So you see the difference between you and me. I only slept with everybody on the show after I got the job.
Oh, yes! That's my girl, yes.
One more thing. Here you go, Sharon. I won't be needing these anymore since this is going to be my last appearance on television. I shall leave them all to you. Because you see, underneath all these Christmas decorations, there is a real person. I don't know if you know what that is, Sharon. I may not have let her show in a while, but she never died. So, here it is, the real thing. Without the glamour. Without the glitter. Without the glitz. I think I'll survive.